Hello children, let us start the new lesson in Civics, Chapter 1, The Indian Constitution. In games like hockey, football, cricket or any other games we play, and these games have terms and conditions or rules. Basic to the game, we can also call them the constitutor rules of the game. Similar to these games, society also has constitutive rules that make it what it is and distinguish it from other kinds of societies. As a country, the people living in it should follow certain rules to maintain peace and equality. These rules are written in a book called the Constitution of India. India is the world's largest democracy and is divided into 28 states and 8 union territories. Then, what is a democracy? A democracy is a system of government in which all the people of a country can vote to elect their representatives. India became a free, democratic and independent country when it gained freedom from the British on 15th August 1947. When a country is formed, it needs a set of laws for the people to follow. This is called the Constitution. The Constitution of India was adopted on 26th January 1950. India was declared a republic on this day. Since then, every year 26th January has been celebrated as Republic Day all over the country. The Constitution was drafted by a drafting committee, the chairman of which was Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Then, what is preamble? The preamble is the introductory which explains the goals of the government. It states the aim and the objectives of the Constitution. Our Indian Constitution is the longest written constitution in the world. The Constitution mentions the goals of our nation, which are democracy, socialism and secularism. It defines the rights and duties of the citizens of the country. It also contains certain guidelines for the government to follow, called the directive principles of state policy. The Constitution of India has 448 articles in 25 parts and 12 schedules. There are 104 amendments that have been made in the Indian Constitution up to January 25th, 2020. What is amendment? It is essential to make modifications in the Constitution according to the changing conditions. These modifications are made through procedure called amendment. An amendment can be defined as a change in the provisions of the Constitution through an act. We pass on to the next topic. Why does a democratic country need a constitution? There are various reasons why a democratic country needs a constitution. Number one, the basic ideals on the basis of which we as citizens aspire to live in our country are mentioned in the Constitution. Number two, it tells the fundamental nature of society. Number three, to define the nature of the political system of the country. Number four, it states a set of rules based on which people belonging to different religions and communities can peacefully coexist with each other. Our next topic is the Constitution of Nepal. In the 1990 Nepal Constitution, the executive powers of the kingdom was entirely in the hands of the king. According to the interim constitution drafted in 2007, the executive powers of Nepal are in the hands of the Council of Ministers headed by Prime Minister. There was a need for new constitution as the ideals of the people had changed. The new constitution will change the rules of the old constitution in order to bring a new society with new ideals. In a democracy, we choose our leaders so that they can exercise power responsibly on our behalf. However, there is always the possibility that these leaders might misuse their authority, and the constitution usually provides safeguards against this. Do you recall the chapter on the Dalit writer Om Prakash Valmiki's experience in school from your class 7 book? In that chapter, we talked about the discrimination Om Prakash faced because he was a Dalit. You read about how the Indian constitution guarantees the right to equality to all persons and says that no citizen can be discriminated against on grounds of religion, caste, race, gender, and place of birth. The rights to equality is one of the fundamental rights guaranteed by the Indian constitution. Another important function that a constitution plays in a democracy is to ensure that a dominant group does not use its power against other, less powerful people or groups. Such unhealthy situations can occur in democratic societies too, where a majority can continuously enforce decisions that exclude minorities and go against their interest. Okay, what is minority? The communities whose population is less than major community are called minority communities. What is majority? The majority is the social group considered to have the most power in a particular place. Every society is prone to this tyranny of the majority. The constitution usually contains rules that ensure that minorities are not excluded from anything that is routinely available to the majority. Another reason why we have a constitution is precisely to prevent this tyranny or domination by the majority of a minority. This can refer to one community dominating another, that is inter-community domination, or members of one community dominating others within the same community, that is intra-community domination. The third significant reason why we need a constitution is to save us from ourselves. This may sound strange, but what is mean by this is that we might at times feel strongly about an issue that might go against our larger interest, and the constitution helps us guard against this. Similarly, the constitution helps to protect us against certain decisions that we might take that could have an adverse effect on the larger principles that the country believes in. For example, it is possible that many people who live in a democracy might come to strongly feel that party politics has become so acrimonious that we need a strong dictator to set this right. Swept by this emotion, they may not realize that in the long run, dictatorial rule goes against all their interests. A good constitution does not allow these whims to change its basic structure. It does not allow for the easy overthrow of provisions that guarantee rights of citizens and protect their freedom. From the above discussion, you will understand that the constitution plays a very important role in democratic societies. Our next topic is key features of our Indian constitution. Number 1, federalism. Number 2, parliamentary form of government. Number 3, separation of powers. Number 4, fundamental rights. And number 5, secularism. Under federalism, it is important because in a country like India, there are people living at different levels and only one level government cannot govern them. Hence, to form a government for the different levels is important. The Panchayat Raj is responsible for governing the village. the state government is responsible for governing the state, and the central government is responsible for governing the entire country. Number 2, parliamentary form of government. A democratic government is one where the citizens of the country have the right to elect their representatives. When the constitution was being made, it was made sure that every citizen of the country, irrespective of caste, color, creed and religion, will have the right to elect their leaders under universal adult suffrage, that is, where the right to vote will be given to all. Number 3, separation of powers. There are 3 organs of governance: legislature, executive and judiciary. Each of these organs have different powers and serve different functions. In order to prevent the misuse of power by any one branch of government, the Constitution says that each of these organs should exercise different powers. Number 4, fundamental rights. The fundamental rights are a set of rights that the Constitution offers to every citizen of the country. These rights include the right to freedom, right to equality, right against exploitation, right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, and to right to constitutional remedies. These rights give every citizen of the country the right to be considered as an equal, to not get discriminated based on caste, culture or religion, to get equal educational opportunities, and to be equal in front of the law. Number 5, secularism. The preamble states that India is a secular country. This means that there will be no state religion. All religions will be treated equally. The Constitution also guarantees the right to freedom of religion as a fundamental right. This includes the freedom to profess, propagate, and practice any religion. Fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are the basic rights that a citizen of India is guaranteed. The following are our fundamental rights in our country. Number 1, right to equality. Everyone is equal under law. Every citizen should be treated equally, irrespective of the person's race, caste, religion, gender, or place of birth. This also includes equality in opportunity regarding employment, access to public places such as parks, malls, playgrounds, museums, hotels, shops, and so on. This right also supports the removal of untouchability. Number 2, right to freedom. This includes the right to freedom of speech, expression, the right to form associations, the right to move freely and reside in any part of the country, and the right to practice any profession, occupation or business. Number 3, right against exploitation. The Constitution prohibits human trafficking, forced labor and employment of children under 14 years of age. Number 4, right to freedom of religion. Religious freedom is provided to all citizens. Every person has the right to practice, profess, and propagate the religion of their choice. Number 5, cultural and educational rights. The Constitution states that all minorities, religious or linguistic, can set up their own educational institutions in order to preserve and develop their own culture. Number 6, right to constitutional remedies. This allows citizen to move the court if they believe that any of their fundamental rights have been violated by the state. Fundamental duties. The following are the fundamental duties of the citizens of this country. Number 1, obey the constitution and respect the national flag and the national anthem. Number 2, we should remember to follow the values and beliefs based on which our freedom struggle took place and not take our freedom for granted. Number 3, protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of the nation. Number 4, we should defend the country and serve the nation when required. Number 5, we should promote harmony and a spirit of brotherhood among all the people of our country. Number 6, we should preserve our rich heritage and culture. Number 7, we should protect our environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife. Number 8, we should develop a hunger for scientific research, a spirit of inquiry and reform. Number 9, we should safeguard public property and avoid violence. Number 10, we should learn more about varied subjects and excel in our personal talent for the development of the society and our country. Conclusion. Coming to the conclusion, we need a constitution because we need a government to protect our natural rights to life, liberty, and property. The constitution is the fundamental law within which the government must operate. We need protection from bad people such as murderers, oppressors, dictators, corrupt people, thieves, robbers, burglars, fraudsters, etc. And this is why we must have a government. We need a constitution. Hereby, I conclude the session. We will meet soon in the next session. Thank you, children. Have a nice day.